It might be good to give a short reminder on sister algebras, so just that we have a common language and the following. So let me just recall the definition of a sister algebra. I'm just talking about unital ones. So a unital sister algebra concretely it's a bounded it's a subalgebra of B of H, which is closed in the operator norm, but of course it can also be defined in an abstract way, and there it is a Banach algebra with some very special properties or some so a sister algebra A, so this is a complex algebra, algebra over C. We have an involution with involution, which we denote by the star, x goes to x star, and we have a norm, it's the usual norm symbol, such that, this algebra should be complete with respect to the norm, so it's a Banach algebra, it's complete with respect to the norm, then, maybe Banach algebra also means that I should have a kind of the multiplicative version of the triangle inequality. A norm always requires a triangle inequality for the sum, but here we are in a setting of an algebra, so we have a product, and then I should, of course, also require for the product this property, and then, of course, it should go nicely together with the star. So this means, of course, the norm of x star should be the norm of x, and this would be something which we call a Banach or star Banach algebra, Banach star algebra. But a C-star algebra is more. So namely, there is a stronger condition which is very specific, namely x times x star, the norm of this has to be equal, not just an inequality, but equal to the norm of x squared. And this has to be true for all, this for all x, and this for all x and y in A. And this is the C star relation, which might not look so interesting or so special, but actually it really, this really tells us that what we are dealing here with are really operators on Hilbert spaces. So that encodes in some way, in algebraic way, the fact that we are dealing with operators on Hilbert spaces, not operators on Banach spaces, but really Hilbert spaces. And then one can show that there are faithful representations of such guys as bounded operators on Hilbert spaces. So that's one of the first theorems and basic theorems in this setting. But maybe now let me also talk about the other crucial thing, namely states, which correspond to representations. So what is a state? A state on our algebra, that's a linear functional, but it should also be positive. So it's a positive unital functional. So a state, let me call it omega, on a C star algebra A. So this is a linear mapping into the complex numbers, so a functional, linear functional, so is a linear mapping. So omega goes from A to C, it's linear, not necessarily multiplicative, so it's not a representation, but it's not just linear, but it has some more structure, so it's unital, omega of 1 is equal to 1, but then it is positive, which means that positive elements are mapped to positive elements, and positive elements in a C-star algebra can always be written in the form xx star. So this should be mapped to a positive element in C, which means it should be a real number greater or equal to 0. So this should be true for all x in A. So that's are the states. And then, of course, we also have the notion of a representation. So we want to represent C-star algebras always on Hilbert spaces as bounded operators on Hilbert spaces. So let me also write this down. So if I have a C star algebra, So what is a representation of it, of C star algebra A on a Hilbert space? Hilbert space, let's say H. So this is a homomorphism which also preserves the star. So this is a star homomorphism. So it's a mapping which is linear multiplicative and preserves the star. Homomorphism, let me call it pi. So this goes from A to bounded operators on this Hilbert space H, and okay, maybe we also require that it should be unital, so the one in my C star algebra. I only consider C star algebras which have a 1, that this goes to the 1 on B of H, which is of course the identity operator. So this is more kind of normalization, but anyhow, so a representation, maybe I should call it a star representation, but anyhow, I want that the star is also preserved. So this is a mapping which preserves all relevant structure, algebraic, all relevant algebraic structure. And it's a point, I mean, it's part of the theory that you also, if the algebraic structure is respected, then you will also get statements about the norm structure. So this is nothing which you should require here, but it's a consequence. Yeah, and now maybe let me also, that's just a definition, but maybe let me give you one theorem, which is maybe one of the very basic ones, which connects the notion of a state and the representation, namely tells you that whenever you have a state, you really can get from this representation of your algebra on a Hilbert space. And this is the famous GNS construction. So let me write this down here. So this is a theorem, which usually goes under the name of GNS construction. And it says the following. So, okay, I'm starting from a C star algebra A, and then I assume I have a state on it. So let omega be a state on a C star algebra A, and then the statement of the theorem is then there exists a representation of my algebra on some Hilbert space, then there exists a representation of my Hilbert of my C star algebra A on Hilbert space H, and in addition, okay, I can also implement, I mean this representation is special for this state omega, namely this state omega is somehow also implemented in this representation as a vector state, which means it corresponds to a unit vector, which maybe I call here omega, so on a Hilbert space H, and a unit vector, a vector of norm 1, which I call here capital omega in H, such that the state, the little omega, so this is a linear functional on a positive linear functional on the algebra, so I should say what is omega of X. If I go to my representation, and there it is the vector state, so it's omega in the product, and now I take pi of x, so I take the image of x in this representation, a bounded operator, apply this to omega, and take the inner product with omega. And this is true for all x in A. So for any state, I find a representation where the state is implemented in this very specific form. So I mean, those are the vector states, which we already have seen in some context, and representations or states of C star algebras can always be brought in this form if you represent your C star algebra in an appropriate way. Good, okay, and maybe the GNS probably most of you know, those corresponds to three names. Huh? So this means the G is for Gelfand, the N is for Neimark, and Gelfand and Neimark introduced the notion of a C-star algebra and developed the basic theory. Huh? So the basic theorems about that commutative C-star algebras are just are just the continuous functions on some compact spaces, and that non-commutative C-star algebras defined in this abstract way are really bounded operators, it's a closed sub-algebra of bounded operators. So there is a faithful representation of such an abstract C-star algebra as a subset, a sub-algebra of bounded operators on a Hilbert space. And of course, for doing this, I mean, this was an important ingredient for this. Okay, and so this was maybe around 1943. So this was the birth of C-star algebras. And the S stands for Siegel, who did maybe a more general version of this, and in particular also promoted or started this point of view, which I hope I have conveyed to you in the last lectures, that actually, I mean, you should use this operator algebraic, this C-star algebraic language for talking about the basic operators and the basic canonical commutation relations in physics. Huh? So this is really, I mean, this kind of, also this quantization ideas and so, they are very much related to Siegel.